Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, to welcome you to Central, we're glad that you're here. And before we begin worship, I invite Buck Rogers to come on up. And he has a presentation to make to some of our folks. Congratulations. A couple announcements on your bulletin. If you can take the right side of your bulletin and just tear that off and register your attendance through the connection card. When the offering comes by, we invite you to put that in there. Also, if you have any prayer concerns, we invite you to lift that up on the card. If you're new to our church and want to find out about how to get involved and to join the church, next Sunday, during the Sunday school hour at 10 o'clock, we'll be meeting with folks who are interested in doing that. So if you'd like to do that, you can make an indication on your connection card. Also, in the bulletin, there's a lot going on. It's about that time of year where we are coming into Thanksgiving and coming into Advent. So there's a lot going on. I know a number of you saw the Advent tree, or actually the angel tree, to bless people whose parents are in prison. You can pick up one of those on the way out. Also, as you leave today, two other things before we begin worship. I just want to encourage you, pick up your monthly newsletter. They'll let you know all the things that are going on in the church as we approach Advent. And you may have seen these as you came in. These are simply invitation cards. The sermon series we're going to do is called Gather at the Manger. And this little card lists all the things that are going on here. We're doing this as a way for you to invite people to come to church. During Christmas time and Advent season, that's when often most people are likely to find a church and to be open to coming to a church. So at the end of the service, our ushers will hand you several of these cards. Feel free to take as many as you like. But I just encourage you through your own personal relationships to invite people to come to church and invite them to join in the things we have going on here. The rest of the announcements are in your bulletin. I'm going to invite you to stand at this moment and greet your neighbor. Welcome them to church this morning.
Thank you.
as we affirm our faith together. We believe in God, creator of the world and God of all people, and in Jesus Christ, incarnate among us, who died and rose again. Let's stop here. Let's all do this together. Okay? Let's all do this together. We believe in God, creator of the world and of all people, and in Jesus Christ, incarnate among us, who died and rose again, and in the Holy Spirit, present with us to guide, strengthen, and comfort. We believe, God, help our unbelief. We rejoice in every side of God's kingdom, in the upholding of human dignity and community, in every expression of love, justice, and reconciliation, in each act of self-giving on behalf of others, in the abundance of God's gifts entrusted to us, that all may have enough in our own responsibilities and our earth's resources. Glory be to God on high, and on earth, peace. We confess our sin, individual and collective, our silence for action, through the violation of human dignity based on race, class, age, sex, nation, or faith, through the exploitation of people because of greed and indifference, through the misuse of power in personal, communal, national, and international life, through the search for security by those military and economic forces that threaten human existence, through the abuse of technology which endangers the earth and all of life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We commit ourselves individually and as a community to the way of Christ, to take up the cross, to seek abundant life for all humanity, to struggle for peace, for justice, and freedom, to risk ourselves in faith, hope, and love, praying that God's kingdom may come. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
God, and we ask, just as Christ taught us to pray, that you may may teach us the power of a thankful heart. God, and now we recite that very prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father,
today is our Thanks for Giving Sunday, and depending upon how familiar you are with the traditions here at Central, the Thanks for Giving Awards are given to folks who serve the church sacrificially, who serve with a humble and positive spirit, who serve up front or behind the scenes, and who serve with the love of Jesus. It's an opportunity on a Sunday to say thank you for all that that these individuals, everybody, but particularly these individuals, have done. In the early service, we honored Aaron Barnes. And today we're going to honor two individuals. The first person we are honoring has been attending our church for the past 4 years and has made a tremendous impact. She always has a smile on her face and has a positive spirit. She believes this is her church and that you should do whatever is needed for the good of the church. She helps plan the Fun Seekers ministry. She waters and talks to our church plants, just like their people. She loves to give hugs. She plans and cooks our Wednesday night meals, which are not only amazing, but they are also cost effective and enables more of our money to go to ministry. One of the ways she likes to greet people is to say, how do? So therefore, I invite you to please give it up for one of our 2017 Thanks for Giving Award winners, to Stacy Evans. Someone who has served Central in so many ways. During this past season of this church life, she has served on the staff parish team. This team has a difficult task of being the liaison between the pastors and the staff and the needs of the church. They deal with many sensitive and confidential issues critical to the functioning of a healthy church. As a leader of this team, she not only sought to deal with individual staff members with grace and truth and love, she's also sought to keep Central UMC on its mission and to do the right thing by the church. One of her favorite pastimes is cooking, and in her final year on staff parish, she and Brenda Allen initiated the Heavenly Helpings Ministry, a food ministry with over 20 folks involved, designed to make healthy home-cooked meals to those who are going through a difficult time and who need the support of their church family. Therefore, it is my pleasure to give a 27 Thanks for Giving Award to Phyllis Wilburn. Lord, thank you for Stacy, thank you for Phyllis, and all the ways they've served up front and behind the scenes. We pray your blessing in my day, that they would hear your voice saying, well done, good and faithful servant. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank God one more time for that. This time, I invite Logan to come forward.
Children and youth have been participating in Operation Christmas Child, so they went out with their families the past couple weeks, and they made all these shoe boxes, and these shoe boxes are going to be shipped to children all over the world. So you guys can come on up. And some of them even got double the amount of shoe boxes they were supposed to get, so that was really great. Look, you guys got two, didn't you? She said she got some Legos, but Mommy said she could have them. You guys, you got some other stuff. You put a lot of stuff in it? Good. I bet someone's really going to love it. All right, so we're going to pray over these boxes together. Dear God, thank you so much for all that you've blessed us with. God, I ask that each one of these shoe boxes just goes to the child and that they would open it up and receive so much joy. And that they would know your love because of this one little box that they get. God, I pray that these boxes would go to the child in need, and that they would just know your love. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, all children, you want to meet with Mom Wendy at the back of the sanctuary? She'll take you to children's church. This is for a girl? Okay, we'll be sure you got a girl who can sit.
This time I invite the ushers to come forward. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, you've blessed us abundantly. Better than we deserve or even can comprehend. We pray, Lord, as we give back to you as you have blessed us with, that you may use the funds gathered here to further your name and your mission. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you.
you're new or visiting with us this morning, my name is Audrey Madigan, and I'm responsible for congregational care here at Central. And I'd like to add my welcome to you, along with the ones that you've already received. I hope you find your time with us a blessed one this morning. Our scripture this morning is the parable of the talents. It comes from Matthew 25, verses 14 to 30. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted them with his property. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who received the 5 talents brought the other 5. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." The man with the 2 talents also came. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then the man who had received the 1 talent came. "Master," he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you." His master replied, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I had not sown, gathered where I had not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I returned, I would have earned it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever has not have, even if he has, well, that will be taken from him. And throw the useless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Loving God, we come today as your people and your church to meet together in your presence. Make yourself known to us in new ways, ways through our prayers, this worship, and our understanding of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. W. John Garner, founding chairman of Common Cause, says it's a rare and high privilege to help people understand the difference they can make, not only in their lives, but in the lives of others, by simply sharing of themselves. Garner tells about a cheerful old man who liked to ask the question, and the same question, of just about every new acquaintance he fell into conversation with. "What have you done that you believe in and are proud of?" He never asked the conventional questions such as, "What do you do for a living?" It was always, "What have you done that you believe in and are proud of?" It was an unsettling question for people who had built their self-esteem on their wealth, or their family name, or their exalted job title. Not that the old man was a fierce interrogator. He wasn't. He wasn't delighted by the woman who answered, "I'm doing a good job raising 3 children. And by the cabinet maker who said, "I believe in good workmanship, and I practice it." And by the woman who said, "I started a bookstore, and it's the best bookstore for miles around." I don't really care how they answer, he said. I just want to put the thought into their minds. They should live their lives in such a way that they have a good answer. Not a good answer for me, but for themselves. That's what's important. Our scripture this morning is one of three parables found in chapter 25. With these stories, Jesus tells us what the kingdom of heaven will be like, what it means to be ready for his return, and how to live until he comes back. The first parable is found in verses 1 to 13, the parable of the 10 virgins. The second is our scripture today, the parable of the talents. And the third is located in verses 31 to 46, the parable of the sheep and the goats. Each story on its own doesn't give us all the information. But instead, like a puzzle, if you piece these three parables together, you get a complete picture. Now, since I'm only discussing the second parable this morning, I'm going to give you some homework this week. I'm going to ask you to read the first and third parables on your own. A man decides to go on a journey, so he calls together three of his servants and entrusts them with his property while he's away. He doesn't give them his wealth. He only loans it to them. To the one servant, he gives 5 talents. To another, he gives 2 talents. And to the third, he gives 1 talent. Now, in studying for this sermon, I found differing descriptions on what a talent is. But the most common description seemed to be that a talent was not a coin. Rather, it was originally a weight of metal. When used in monetary terms, if the metal wasn't specified, people would have understood it to be silver. Now, the exact amount varied, but a talent of silver was likely to have been 6,000 denarii. Now, if you consider 1 denarii was normally a day's wage for a day laborer during this time, a single talent would represent what a laborer might hope to earn an entire lifetime. To give you an idea of how much these men received, then 5 talents would have been worth 30,000 denarii, and 2 would have been worth 12,000 denarii. All these men received a huge amount of money, even the one who only received 1 talent. We are told that each man received according to his ability. He received according to his ability. That is, no one received more or less than they could deal with. Now, this is pretty ingenious, actually, on the master's behalf. For by doing this, if the servants failed to take care of his money, no man could say that he was given more than he could handle. The men didn't complain about what they received and the fact that they received differing amounts. And there was no hint of jealousy or grief. They simply accepted what was given them. What I find interesting is the master didn't tell them what to do with the money. He simply gave it to them and left. You could almost feel the excitement and eagerness of the servants with the 5 and 2 talents, for that we are told they went at once and put their money to work. They were so grateful to have such an amazing opportunity that they wanted to do the best they could with it. And they did. They doubled it. However, it doesn't seem the third servant shared the same excitement as the others. For instead of going and putting it to work, he put his talent into the ground. After a long period of time, we're told the master comes back and asks for a report of his money. He's very pleased with the servants who returned the full amount plus interest. And he tells them that because they have been faithful in a few things, he will make them charge over many. But when the servant who received the 1 talent only returned what was originally given him, The master becomes furious with him. And for not doing what he had asked, what he had wanted him to do, though he didn't specify it, he didn't earn any more money. In a rage, the master takes the one talent and gives it to the man with 10, and then has the non-productive servant thrown into the street. This parable had a meaningful message for the people 2,000 years ago, and it has several for us today. In fact, a whole sermon series could be preached on just this one parable. For the people listening directly to Jesus, the mention of talents would have meant some kind of currency. However, for us, talents can represent any resource given to us by God. Our time, our treasures, our natural aptitudes, our abilities. F.D. Bruner tells us, a talent is whatever the Lord gives us now and will ask us about later. We'll need to remember that, won't we? One of golf's immortal moments came when a Scotsman demonstrated the new game to President Ulysses Grant. Carefully placing the ball on the tee, he took a mighty swing. The club hit the turf and scattered dirt all over the president's beard and surrounding vicinity, while the ball, quite undisturbed, rested on the tee. Again, the Scotsman swung, and again he missed. President Grant waited patiently through 6 tries, and then quietly stated, "There seems to be a fair amount of exercise in this game, but I fail to see the purpose of the ball." God gives us each amazing gifts in various forms, based on our natural talents, so that we can multiply them for God's kingdom and for God's glory. Unlike President Grant's impression of the golf ball, our gifts have a purpose. And that purpose is that they are to be used in God's service. When we do this, our talent can be a blessing not only to ourselves but to others. An impact lies in very direct and meaningful ways. As with the servants in our parable, God does not leave anyone out. We don't all get the same gift or the same amount of gifts, but we all receive them, and they are given to us according to our ability to use them. God doesn't give us capabilities we could not manage, apply, or invest in some way to increase their value. God never demands skills that we don't have. Because of this, we have no excuses not to use them. We have no excuses because God has promised to equip us and help us in whatever he has asked us to do. For God, it's not our capabilities that matters. What matters for God is that we faithfully use them in service to God and to God's people. 1 Peter 4, 10-11 says, "Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful servants of God's grace in various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength of God that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ." Let me give you an example of how our gifts may not be equal, but God can use them to have an equal impact. For 8 months this year, I did clinical pastoral education training at UT Medical Center, chaplaincy training. The training required that I do 600 hours of clinical training and 200 hours in class training. Spending that much time at the hospital, I got to see all kinds of people from all different walks of life. And I got to observe employees from all kinds of disciplines. But the employees I worked with the most were the doctors, the nurses, and the cleaning staff. Now, the cleaning staff could have looked at the doctors and the nurses and say, "Look at those medical people. They use skills I can't even imagine having or using." And the nurses use different skills than the doctors, and the doctors use different abilities than the nurses. But on the one level, it might be true that, yes, these medical people save lives. And maybe they thought, the cleaning staff thought that they just cleaned rooms. But if you looked at it the way that God sees their work, when they put their heart into it, these people cleaned the rooms, but in doing so, eliminate germs and bacteria that could have caused life-threatening diseases. By doing what they did, they save lives, too. And they save them in all kinds of ways. As a new chaplain at the hospital, my shifts were always at night and on the weekends. And when I would get called to one of five of the intensive care units, they were all on different various floors of the hospital. And invariably, I would get lost. And when people would look at me and see me worried and confused, it wasn't the doctors who stopped to guide me to the right place. It was the cleaning staff. These wonderful people would rescue me every time. They would turn me around and point me in the right direction, and by doing so, allowed me to do the work that God had asked me to do. I love how William Barclay explains this. People are not equal in talent, but they are equal in effort. Let me say that again. People are not equal in talent, but they can be equal in effort. Whatever talent we have, little or great, we must lay it at the service of God. And this is the mistake the third servant made. He was not willing to use whatever he had been given to benefit his master. His master called him lazy and wicked, and that might have been true. Where the servant could have felt that since his work would only benefit the master and not him, why should he knock himself out to do something for someone else? Or, after all, the guy had all the money he needed. Why should he make him more? However, the servant tells his master that he's afraid. He's afraid because this is a man who is hard. And he was afraid that if he lost all or part of the man's money, he would be harmed in some way. Not only does a servant call his master hard, but he also calls him deceitful and a cheat. Talk about not knowing when to quit. He does this to take the focus off himself by redirecting it on his master. Instead of taking responsibility for his own mistake, he tries to avoid both by putting the blame on someone else. The master tells a servant that if he knew him to be a dishonest person, then he would know him that he would have wanted some kind of return from the servant. And at the very least, the servant could have invested his money in the bankers. Not only did the servant not increase what was given to him, he didn't even try. He didn't lose the master's money. He just chose not to do anything with it. The third servant was only thinking about himself. He didn't appreciate the gift or the opportunity he had been given. He was lazy and unfaithful and reluctant to work on his master's behalf. As a result, he was punished for his selfishness and his unwillingness to risk. Like the master in this story, God gives us talents. Talents that God expects us to use and multiply until the Son of Man returns. Our gifts are not ours to keep or ours to hide. They've been entrusted to us to be used to serve God by serving others. God does not give us the same or the same amount of gifts. However, we all receive wonderful gifts based on individual, natural talent and in our abilities. None of us receive capabilities we can't handle or apply because God has promised to equip us for whatever task God has asked us to do. Because of this, we're not to look at other people's talents with jealousy or greed, but trust in God's wisdom that God has provided the perfect ability for what He expects us to do. Two of the servants understood this, and out of faithfulness to their master, increased his estate. The servant was selfish and played it safe. Like the two servants in the story, we can be grateful for the talents we have and excited about using them in service to God and others. After all, that's one of the great things about being a Christian, discovering the abilities that are unique to us and then watching and responding to the opportunities God gives us to use them. I invite you to take a moment today and look back over this year. Has God opened doors for you this year that you never thought you would ever walk through? Have you been put in places you never considered going because you're willing to follow God, even though you doubted he knew what he was doing? I know this has happened to many of you because I have watched you. I have watched you discover talents you never thought you possessed. And then I have watched you be willing to risk and do things in new and exciting ways. And as a result, I have watched you grow in your abilities to serve God. God is the master of us all. And God has given us time, talents, and opportunities to serve God by serving others. We are expected to use whatever we are given and not play it safe by doing nothing or using our gifts only to benefit ourselves. As Christians, we're not to compare our gifts. We're not to be jealous of what others have received, but accept what we have been given with eagerness and gratitude. And the more we use our gifts in faith, the more capable we become. The more we are able to do, and the more God entrusts to us. If we truly love God, we will want to use our talents to make his name great and to increase his kingdom here on earth, and to grow in our faith and our discipleship. When we use our talents to help others, our lives have more purpose and receive a joy and a satisfaction in what we're doing, regardless of how much money, recognition, or power we receive. I had to put this hockey story in today for Aaron, because he was the person who won the award in the first service, and he's a big hockey player. So this was to honor Aaron. In February 1980, the U.S. Olympic hockey team walked away with a gold medal in Lake Placid, New York. This team shocked the world by upsetting the powerful Soviet Union and grabbing the championship from Finland. Before his team's victory over the Soviet Union, which advanced them to the finals, the coach of the U.S. hockey team told his players, "You were born to be a player. You were meant to be here at this time. This is your moment." Like the master, Jesus went away, but he has promised that he's coming back. And as the master asked for accounting of his servants, Jesus tells us in this parable that he will ask for accounting also. So I say to you this morning, you are born to be God's servant. You are meant to be here at this time. God has given you abilities so that you might bring about his kingdom here on earth now. This is your moment. You have the choice to get up every morning to view the day as an opportunity to serve God and to serve others, to invest our lives in God's work and what is God's will. Wherever we go is a privilege. This parable describes two ways we can prepare for Christ's return. We can be faithful to God and devote ourselves to investing our talents in doing God's work by serving God in whatever ways God asks us to act on his behalf, and in doing so, advance his kingdom. Or we can play it safe. We can keep our talents to ourselves, and we can be reluctant to work for our master. The question we have today is, which servant will you be? Please pray with me. Loving God, we humbly thank you for your unending grace and mercy given so freely to us. We thank you for the abundance of gifts, talents, resources, and opportunities that you offer us. Help us to receive all these things with gratitude and use them for your glory. All this we pray, that as you deepen our Christian joy and assurance, we will have the opportunity to extend your kingdom. In your Son's strong name we pray. Amen. I would like to just welcome someone in particular this morning. And his name is Zach Williams. Zach Williams is back from South Korea, where he's been doing training. And he's a wonderful son of this congregation. And so, Zach, it's so great to have you back, and back in one piece. I'm sure your parents are very grateful also.
So make sure you greet Brenda today. And before Audrey gives a benediction, I really encourage you to take one of those cards, invite someone to come to church, someone who needs to hear some good news this season.
Receive now this benediction. Go now as gifted people, willing to risk and serve God in whatever way God asks. And may He bless you and keep you now and forever. May the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a good week, everyone.